Hi everyone in cloud computing and welcome to episode 64 of the Cloud Computing Training Show, as featured on YouTube and podcast with Brad Nelson and internationally recognized and the world's number one cloud industry expert and thought leader David Linthicum. This show is sponsored by Nelson Hilliard, cloud computing recruitment specialist placing great people in cloud, IoT, fintech and AI. In this week's show we are talking about the US Army is building a giant VR battlefield to train soldiers virtually, and it's taking advantage of cloud-based computing and the latest virtual reality technology called Synthetic Training Environment. The initiative aims to create a unified training environment for the infantry, so it lets soldiers practice combat scenarios hundreds of times without dying. Hi Dave, it's great to see you again and welcome back on the training show this week.
Yeah, it's great to be back, and yeah, you don't like to die.
No, dying's not good. No, dying's not good, especially in a virtual reality environment. But, you know, hey, they can go back and try again and get better at killing people and saving lives, obviously. So look, let's have an opening question then is, will the simulation be the domain of cloud computing in the next few years? And I guess, like, you know, do you see it impacting cloud training?
Yeah, this is a big, you know, growth area for cloud computing. Actually, Google just got back into the gaming industry. You know, and there's really not a lot different than what the U.S. Army is doing here with their synthetic training environment. And, you know, all of the video games that people are addicted to right now that, you know, people are leveraging. And so it kind of makes sense. And I think that ultimately we're moving to a point where it is going to be a virtual battlefield. We're going to run these wars in, and that's how people are going to learn how to fight wars and learn how to be military combatants. Also, the ability to leverage things that are unmanned, you know, unmanned tanks and drones and things like that. So it's getting into some, you know, really, you know, questionable areas if you have, you know, some issue with that, things like that. But the reality is that we can take this sort of training and apply it to different things. We can apply it to, you know, people who are building buildings so they operate safely. We can apply it to people who are, in essence, doing sports. We can apply it to new drivers, providing them with a virtual alley environment. So, you know, teenagers don't go out there and they always have, accidents in the first few years. And some of them, you know, the fatalities are very high. The ability to figure out how to ride motorcycles, the ability to do things that have any kind of physical and strategic kind of complication, we can leverage this technology to make that happen. And cloud computing seems to be a destination for that, because virtual reality stuff is just so computationally intensive and IO intensive that it just makes sense for me to run it on a cloud-based system than it does than if I'm running on a $10,000 server that's sitting next to my desk, because that $10,000 server is going to be obsolete in a year or two, and the cloud-based systems are going to be continuously updated and continuously improved. So the lesson here is not the fact that we can learn how to go fight a war better, but it's we can learn how to do other things better as well. And so we were able to go off and look at anything physical and basically train your brain to make it happen. So flight simulators, you know, we're obviously well aware of those, but the ability to do them with very inexpensive VR kinds of scenarios. But, you know, police officers who have to face, you know, very challenging things, and they're often criticized for it, and make split-second decisions and the right decisions. Well, they do have simulators they're playing in now, which are real-life things that people go into. What if you're able to, you know, hook them up to a VR-based system and have the reality just kind of immersed to what they're doing, so it's not necessarily even seem to their brain like it's a training scenario? So we're entering this world where the ability to train people in a physical, kind of environment, your ability to be absorbed, and there's a million different applications for that with the virtual reality stuff, is starting to become a real reality. I mean, some of the virtual reality stuff that I've, seen demoed to me in the last, 5 years was really kind of hokey. I didn't really get a lot out of it. It kind of made me seasick. But some of the stuff I've been seeing lately in terms of designers who are able to walk through a building and your ability to kind of, build a house and have this experience with it, before it's even built or before the foundation is even laid. It's really amazing stuff. And so the good thing about that is we're not going to get as many people hurt in training accidents if we're providing synthetic training, whether it's, construction or in this case, it's doing war. And cloud computing is really going to have the ability to kind of share those things coming forward. So it used to be very siloed systems that were built by particular companies focused on a particular market. Now the same virtual reality modeling, the same rendering technologies, things like that, that work for a synthetic training environment for the U.S. Army, you know, can work for a construction environment, can work for police simulation, can work for race car simulation, can work for all these other things that are typically very dangerous. We're trying to train people on, change their brains, in essence, to assume that these things are going to happen and have these things basically being built into them as muscle memory. And that's the only way you can do it is repetition. And so this stuff's going to save lives. It's going to be the way in which we train going forward. I've used some of these before, prior to with some success. I think that it went from very cute technology just a few years ago that something's that's extremely viable that we're going to have to adopt, you know, that most organizations are going to adopt going forward if they're facing, you know, this kind of training. So it's a good thing overall.
Yeah, I agree. I think you've touched on some really interesting points there. And I actually saw a pretty cool documentary on HoloLens the other day, and it was just fantastic. And I mean, bringing it into a cloud context, you can actually, you know, we often talk on cloud training about, you know, the archaic form of training where everyone's got to fly to a central location, waste a day flying, you know, settle in, you know, all this sort of stuff. Whereas, you know, people in this virtual environment for training could, in theory, just log in and actually arrive into an actual destination in a virtual reality complex, or, you know, hire a virtual space or something like that, where you've got your testing facility and everything like that, where people can still engage and interact, but in a real-time virtual world. And HoloLens just seem to really nail that in this particular a demonstration of a design company that was working on several, I think it was a toy, I'll try and find the link and put it in the description box or something, but it was for a toy company that was designing new toys and sharing ideas across the world with all these people that had come to one singular place in HoloLens on this particular server, obviously, to share all this work. And I just thought it was absolutely, you know, fantastic to see. And this is pretty recent. I've seen HoloLens a few years back and it was a bit jerky. It wasn't quite there and it was just showing a shark swimming and stuff like that. But this was, you know, people, it was very much a minority report kind of environment, and I think for training that's going to be very efficient, don't you think?
Yeah, I hope so. It'll keep me off of airplanes, and the ability to kind of you know, do more with less time, and, you know, be more efficient with your time, things like that, and the ability to kind of meet in these virtual environments and have people accept it as a meaningful way in which we can exchange information and do training remotely. That's another application for it. You know, something it's a foregone conclusion. It's just a matter of changing culture, changing adoption of the technology, and also the technology coming down in price. Cloud computing is going to have a big part of that because, like I said, the real cost is in the back-end processing and the rendering systems and things like that that just will take most computers to their knees to keep up with that. And that's probably why it was jerky. So our ability to, in essence, lease these environments and rent these environments and share these environments and use them as a jumping off point for most of the training scenarios. It's just something that people need to adopt. So hopefully, I'm not a big fan of classroom training. I think we talked about that. You know, hopefully we'll keep people out of classrooms. We'll keep them engaged with more interesting topics. If we don't have to hop on airplanes every time we have to go meet somebody or do some virtual training, and that's an accepted reality. And it just becomes a lot more efficient. And we'll, you know, like I said, well, lots of great things. I'll be more efficient if I don't have to, you know, sit on airplanes or in airports with delayed flights, which I do a good part of my life. And also the ability to, in essence, level the playing field for how we, you know, how we're able to meet and communicate and, you know, how we can do the training stuff. And I think that this is something that is not only coming, I think it's here. I think it does have some acceptance to occur, and that typically takes a 5-year cycle to make it happen. I think training is going to be the best application for this stuff, and I think cloud computing made it happen.
Yeah, 100% agree with you, sir. And it moves us on nicely to your top 3 tips, if you'd be so good to share.
Yeah, sure. Number one, keep in mind that we're looking for an end state, and so what is the best training to make this happen with the least amount of money and the least amount of risk and the least amount of negative impact to the people who are learning from these environments? And so that should be kept in mind. Again, we talked about this in the C-suite show. We have a tendency to go after technology for technology's sake, and that should be factored out of this. This is, we're looking to train people better and what's the best way to make it happen. So I think that people lose sight of it just because they get so enamored with the technology that they end up misapplying it. And as you, you know, talked about with the holiday thing, it's just not there for a while. It does take some baking and some settling in to make happen. I remember conference calls over the internet, 10 years ago were horrible. You couldn't hear, it was breaking up, and you know, it just, people would give up and we'd go to, you know, back to conference lines. And now with the technology we have in Skype, what we're talking on right now, you know, Zoom and some other things, just an accepted standard in how we communicate one to another. But it took 10 years to get the issues out and perfect the technology. I think this is going to go through a similar cycle. Keep in mind that network latency could be an issue. And so if we are doing things that are very connected and we're, you know, connecting in a back-end cloud, that if these are mission critical kinds of things, in other words, if it stops, we're in trouble, those should be calculated into it. So edge-based devices and things that can keep things moving, you know, while there is intermittent disruption in service should be considered, things like that. We have to consider the limitations of the technology. And the processing power is where the investment needs to be made. And you don't want to be making that investment. We just talked about that. So if you're buying a Cray XMP, you know, back in, you know, 85 when I got out of college, which, you know, Boeing had when I was working there, very cool looking computers. But, you know, that was obsolete a couple of 3 years, and it was, you know, $15-20 million, I think, for those things initially. And so now we're dealing with processing, which is very similar in speed and, you know, in the MIPS it's able to perform. And the last thing you want to do is invest in that. And so you want the cloud providers to, in essence, take that over, maintain that. You want to rent that equipment, things like that. And so they're going to basically suffer the investment risk in making that happen.
Yeah, absolutely. Great top tips. We totally agree with everyone else doing the heavy lifting. We'll just do the other stuff.
Yeah.
Great top tips. And thanks, Dave, for being part of the three shows this week, including the training show. Really appreciate your time.
Always a pleasure.
Thank you. And thanks for watching, everyone. We hope you enjoyed watching this week's training show. Remember, we've got the C-Suite show and the Australia show as well this week, so go back and watch those. They're really good fun, actually. We had good fun. Although we didn't have a special guest, so it was just me and Dave, which was good. Always good to just be me and Dave on the shows. But check those out. Remember, Dave's on Twitter, which is at David Linthicum. I'm on Twitter at Nelson_Hilliard. All the social media stuff is in the description box, including the links to our blogs and all that stuff as well. So remember, we're on iTunes and Stitcher. Remember to mention it on the show as well. So check those out as well, so you can listen to us on the podcast. Make sure you subscribe to those as well, and subscribe and like to the videos and comment and share them. It's really important to us. I put a lot of work into these shows, and we really love all the feedback we get on social media. So thanks for watching, and until next week.